Open RAN has reached a tipping point in telecom marked by a convergence of factors. Here to explore why this moment is significant and the driving forces behind it are Cristina Rodriguez, VP of Intel's Network and Edge Group and GM of its Wireless Access Network Division, and Paul Miller, Chief Technology Officer at Wind River. Welcome to you both. Cristina, I want to start with you. The tipping point is defined as the point at which a series of small changes or incidents become significant enough to cause a larger, more important change. What are your thoughts on the path that Open RAN has taken to get here and why we've reached this pivotal moment?
Well, first of all, there was a wide, industry-wide realization that we needed a more modern network architecture. An architecture that would allow us to fulfill all the ambitions and all the use cases that we have in mind and that we want to offer. We needed a more modern network that would allow to have a wide ecosystem participation that lower the barrier of entry for new participants, and that is built in a common, open, programmable, full programmable platform based on general purpose processor, no purpose built solutions, and that will unleash all the possibilities of innovation. So I would say that's number one. Number two is we needed the technology that supported that ambitions, right? And after many years of investing and creating new solutions, we're at a point where we can truly have a fully software defined network. We can run the entire workload, the entire RAN workload on the CPUs and in a server architecture, server-based network architecture that can process the entire RAN workload all the way to layer one, fully virtualized. That was the second one. And then the third one, I would say, is where we are in this journey, in this process. The operators, both brownfield, greenfield, across the entire world, started with proof of concept, lab trials, field trials, and now we're at a point where they are deploying at a scale, commercially at a scale, thousands of virtual cell sites, making it very clear that we are in a point of no return in this journey, and making very clear the benefits of this open software-defined network.
And Cristina, how do you see either business or technology pressures influencing this shift?
Yeah, great question. I would say there are three things that are putting pressure and encouraging this movement. Number one, 5G. We have been deploying 5G for a while now, for a few years now. There have been significant deployment made, but now it's time to monetize that investment. And there is an intention, obviously, to make that monetization happen, not only in the public side, in the public network, but also private network, spanning enterprise and industry, traditional market, new market. Right, and we need that modern network that I was talking about before to deliver new services, reduce the cost, just both in CapEx and OpEx, and then just in general unleash the limitless potential of innovation. And again, that can only be done to the full potential with an open software-defined, software-upgradable network. So that I would say was the first pressure. Second one is our energy focus, right? It is an industry mission. It is in every operator top priority to reduce their footprint, their energy footprints. We all know that the telecom industry is one of the most power intense from the consumption point of view industries in the planet. And the operators are looking for solutions to reduce, again, that power consumption. And with an open software-defined network, you have a lot more possibilities of innovation, of it to optimize that energy efficiency and start breaking our energy curve. And then lastly, I would say artificial intelligence. We all know AI will be everywhere, from edge to cloud to network everywhere, and every AI workload will be accessible to all the different vertical solutions. But the thing with RAN is you need an AI solution that matches the stringent performance per watt requirements that we have in the RAN in the RAN space. We need something that can be deployed, a solution, a capability that can be deployed in the virtual DU, that you don't have to go all the way to the data center. And especially if, once you are in the VDU, you cannot have somebody consuming enormous amount of power, having external power-hungry components. So you want to have that capability again within the CPU in the same server architecture, within the same open and software-defined network.
We know some of how we got here, Paul, but what happens next? What do you see as the larger, more important changes that we're moving into?
Thanks, Clarence. And, you know, I think it's, as we talk about a tipping point event, it's really worth talking briefly about how we got here. And Intel and Wind River have been working together for many, many years, even predating the existence of cloud-native technology that's now used extensively in virtualizing radio access network, and before Kubernetes, before 2014 even. And Intel has kind of emerged as a de facto standard for the processor platforms, the accelerator technologies, the network interface technologies that we use in our open source software. At the same time, though, as we looked at the legacy solutions for virtualizing technology, we realized that existing approaches weren't going to be sufficient. When you look at a radio access network, the need to support a geo-distributed architecture where you have tens of thousands of sites that are coming together as one virtualized cloud, even though they're fully geo-distributed, that required a different approach. And so Intel and Wind River co-founded an open source initiative that Cristina was referencing called Starling X, and that's hosted in the Open Infrastructure Foundation. And this is where we upstream all of this technology that we're talking about here. The enablement of Open RAN, virtualized RAN, and the high scale deployments is all actually open source, done in an open community environment. Now, as we started working through that, we started seeing some amazing successes. Early adopters such as Verizon have now gotten to tens of thousands of nodes deployed, running in excess of six nines high performance. We've developed teams that have an understanding of how to operationalize these systems in the network. And as you'll see later on in this tipping point event, we have customers now talking to KPIs that exceed the performance of legacy RAN solutions, that edge sites can be deployed astonishingly at 90% less manpower time than the legacy approaches. And then finally, as we move forward into the future, we're starting to see the ecosystem really come together. The RAN providers, the infrastructure providers, the hardware systems providers such as Dell are coming together to perform integration prior to bringing it into the customer environment. And this is having a massive impact on operations TCO, lowering that for the customer, and lowering their effort and increasing their ease of adoption of these technologies. So really getting to that level where we've had this incredible amount of investment over many, many years in the Open RAN community, in the hardware architectures, in the virtualization technologies, and in the RAN applications. And then finally getting into deployment. Now for multiple years of deployment at very, very high scale, we're truly at a tipping point where this technology can be adopted, it can be deployed. Now, to answer your question, as we move forward into the future, we've got some really exciting things happening. The amount of automation that's required in these disaggregated networks to really improve operations efficiency is driving AI and advanced automation capabilities into these platforms to really help solve these problems. At Mobile World Congress shortly, we'll be demonstrating some of those things in our booth, and we encourage you to stop by and see that. We'll also see, as Cristina mentioned, new investments in power efficiency, in particular using the capabilities of Intel Xeon processors to manipulate dynamically PNC states in combination with the VDU workload, allows the radio access network application to dynamically manage the power consumption of the underlying platforms. And we're getting to a place where this is dramatically lower cost and more efficient as a fully software-defined architecture that's deployed in edge networks. So very excited about the future and very excited that we've finally reached a point where mass adoption of this technology can be taken forward in a very safe manner.
Cristina and Paul, thank you both for your time today and for sharing your valuable insights.
Thank you for having us.
Yes, thank you for having us. Great conversation today.